Thank you. So thank you, Paris. It's a pleasure being here. So who is already using Postgres 11? Raise your hand. Okay, at least a few of you. So this is a new feature introduced with Postgres 11 for B-tree indexes. It's called include or non-key columns. Who has heard of that already? Okay, who was confused by it? Ah, yeah, okay. So it's an interesting topic, let's put it that way. To fully understand it, you need to have also a certain understanding of how indexes work, in particular B-tree indexes, and how index-only scan works in Postgres. So I will start with these topics. How does a B-tree index work in Postgres? And then later on, we will see how the include columns change that behavior. So first and foremost, we always have something like a table in Postgres, like here down, the red bar. It's a heap table, it's called heap. And if you want to create an index there, a B-tree index, the essential part is that you have some keys which are then put into a so-called doubly linked list in a particular order. So they are basically ordered as though you would put them into an order by clause. And each of these keys also has this pointer to where the actual row lives in the table, the CTID. So you can have many of those keys. Basically, every row gets one of these keys in a normal way. And some of them will be stored as a so-called page, which has something like 8 kilobytes per default. And then, if you want to have more keys in this index, then you need more pages, of course. And all of them, they are pointing down to the table in a pretty chaotic way. So once you have found one of the keys, it's easy to find the corresponding entry in the table, but that's it. So you have many of them, and unfortunately, this is just logically ordered. It's not physically ordered. So just because the way I've drawn it here doesn't mean that one is stored further to the end than the other one. They are basically shuffled. So to still make good use of them and find data quickly, we need a second component. And this is where the name tree comes in. It's the B tree. And it's basically a search structure where for each of these pages, you repeat one of the keys so that you can more easily find your way down if you start at the top, at the so-called root node, to find the nodes at the end, where you can then eventually hop over to the table. So something like this is basically what happens if you create an index on some key column K. And if you're going to use this index then by a query like I have it here, select something where K equals something, the database will first fetch the root node and look in there and use those key values to find out which next node to follow. And in my example, I'm just taking that one, the yellow highlighted one, and then it will check again all the key values so that it eventually finds a leaf node where this search term is present, if it is present at all in this table. And once it has found that, it can also go and follow the pointer down to the table so that you can fetch also the heap blocks in the table, which I have just a small yellow marks in here, but they are still full pages, basically 8 kilobytes. And if you happen to fetch many rows, then you need to go to the table many times. And that's pretty common. That's what's happening all the time if you're using an index. And of course, it may take a while. And if you count the number of pages you are accessing, then you'll see that maybe in the index you have 1, 2, and then maybe the third, 4, 5 there, but down in the table, you can have many more. It is quite common that the vast majority of page access that you're doing is coming from the table access. So, and then we have the index-only scan. That was introduced with Postgres 9.2 already, so you have it, hopefully. Is anyone running anything other than 9.2? Okay, is anyone running something elder and brave enough to commit it? No, nobody. So I hope nobody is running anything like 9.1 or older. So starting from 9.2, there's a trick, the so-called index-only scan. You might have seen it in an execution plan already. And it basically means if you happen to put all the data you are querying, like here, I'm basically querying a column data, and I'm searching on the key. if you happen to include all of that into the index, then there is actually no reason to go to the table anymore. That's the general idea. So you can prevent going down there. But there's just one gotcha. Who knows that? Who knows what the problem is with the index-only scan? Yes, there one. Do you want to say it? Visibility. The visibility. So what's that? In Postgres, the so-called visibility, which is used to isolate, to implement transaction isolation, so that nobody sees something which you have not yet committed, is stored in the table only. So each row, each tuple, has two more columns, which are used to identify which transactions are allowed to see that row. So the problem is, although I have all that payload in the index itself, this meta information, which the database needs to check, is not available in the index itself. It's only there in the heap. So what was done at that time with 9.2 was that this visibility information, already before in 8.4, they implemented something called the visibility map. This was a very dense data structure where it is noted that if there is a heap page where all the rows are visible to all the transactions, then we mark it there so that everybody who knows who, there is a row stored which I'm interested in there automatically also knows that it is visible to all transactions. That includes my own transaction. So 8.4 basically introduced that, but only to speed up vacuum, to not go where we are sure that there's nothing to vacuum. And at that time, the vacuum was not crash safe. So in case there was no recovery procedure for that, you just did it again, which was no problem because it was only used to speed up the vacuum process. So what it does is there is this basically this flag which says in this page, everything is clear, which also means it is visible to all transactions. And the vacuum process itself takes care of cleaning those. And then 9.2 made this visibility map crash safe so that we can also rely upon it for queries. Now we can be sure if it is marked as clean, then all rows in this block are visible to all transactions. So that includes my own transaction, and thus I don't need to go to the heap table. However, this is a block-by-block, a page-by-page decision. That means the index-only scan, which you might know from the execution plan already, it first checks the visibility map. In case this page is not clear, it still has to go to the heap table to check the visibility of this particular row. So this is what we already had. So this is basically 9.2 index-only scan. And now we have this include clause in B3 indexes. What is it about? So syntactically, it just follows the key part in the create index. So you have the parentheses closed because this is the end of the key part, and then you can include more data. And the way it changes, if you look at the index again, in the leaf nodes and only in the leaf nodes, these include columns are also added to the index. In all of them, of course, but they are not part of the ordering key and also not part of the search tree, as you see there. In the root node here, I have just the key. The include columns are only at the lowest level, at the leaf node level, nowhere else. So they cannot be used for efficient search. Also, the include is not used for the sorting down here. Although the keys are sorted logically, the include is not considered during this sorting. So why? So one of the reasons you can already see in this picture. The tree is not as deep anymore because you only include the white data maybe in the lowest level and not through the entire tree. So that's one reason. Also, let's look at how this is used. I'm querying again some data column just by the key, and it just loads the root node, follows one of the pointers according to the key values, will find this, this leaf node, and then have all the data there, and can instantly actually fetch everything. But of course, it also has to consider this visibility map thing. So in case your database, your table is not properly vacuumed, then it will still need to go to the heap table to check the visibility. So let's have a look. Pro and con of this include column versus the key columns, which you already know. So the advantages, we have already seen one of them. It is not so deep, because you only include a part of the keys, the key itself through the entire tree, but you can have more data at the lowest level. You're not enforced to put it into the tree as well. Another benefit, it is smaller at all because it needs fewer blocks, but that is really negligible. You can basically a few percent at all. That's not the reason to actually do it. But when there are advantages, there must be disadvantages as well. And I would like to go through them with you. So if you have a query like this, select star from k equals something and data equals something. And if you have an index that has both these columns in the key part, then you will get a very efficient execution plan, which basically reads the index and can do so by just reading five pages here in my example. And it can do both. It can use the key and the data for actually traversing this index and actually find that those rows very efficiently. If you would instead put the data column into the include part of the index, then you would get an execution plan like this, which is, you see it instantly, it's way more complex. So we have, instead of a single index scan, we have bitmap index scan here, followed by the bitmap heap scan up there. And when you see there, even the buffers read here on the index itself is way more. But more importantly, the index condition does not mention the filter on the data column. It's only mentioning the key column. We see then further up that the heap access is hitting many, many heaps, 10,000 basically, and there it is applying this filter on the data and removing almost all of them. So what's happening here is basically the filtering does not happen on index level. It happens then at the heap node level. Although the data itself, it is available in the index, it is not used here. And the reason for that, like I figured out 2 weeks ago when I was preparing this, this presentation, I asked on the mailing list, and apparently that the reason is that these include columns, they don't have operator classes associated with them. Interestingly, operator classes, they are not really important for this filtering. The reason why it is important in this case is because there is a sequence which is followed by Postgres. The first one is it does all the filtering on so-called safe operations, where it is known that no exception will be raised. Then it is checking the visibility, which it cannot be done in the bitmap index scan at all. It's never checking for visibility. It's not an index-only scan. The visibility is checked only at the heap table. So then it's checking the visibility, and then it's filtering the unsafe operations, those which might cause exceptions. And the reason is that if you have deleted data in the table, which is quite common, that you do not run code which might cause an exception, because then you would get the exception even if the data is already deleted. So therefore, the sequence is also only the safe operations, then the visibility check, then the potentially unsafe operations. And the bitmap index scan has no way to figure out if this is visible, so it's basically still happening on the heap access. So this index is, for this query, basically as bad as though you would not have the data column in the include at all. If you look it into this picture, of course, it starts at the root node, it goes down, but the interesting part is at that stage, while it is still in the index, it's basically ignoring the data in the include because of the issue with the possible exceptions if this happens to be deleted data already. So what it does instead, it just goes through, goes to the heap table, then it knows which of those rows are still visible, not yet deleted, or already committed in either way. And only for those which are visible to my transactions, the filtering is applied. So you see, if we look at the disadvantages, it does not help the WHERE clause at all. And I think that's quite essential. But let's go on. If we just select data which happens to be in the include clause. Let's see how the index-only scan is affected by that. So if we have the data column in there and we are just asking for data, then we will see the index-only scan there. And that will be very efficient. We could even save some heap access. But let's look at the other side. Here, now we can also see the index-only scan. There it is. It's just one operation, no bitmap scanning anymore. And what we still see is that it still needs to read more data blocks, like 56 compared to 5, because it needs to go through the entire key values that match this query. So only on the index side, only this condition is applied to limit the range of data read in the index. And then we still have these rows removed by filter 10,000 or 9,999, but this is now happening at the index level, because the index-only scan, it just goes to the visibility map and then applies the filter which might be unsafe and does call an exception. So the index-only scan is actually the only one, the only operation that does this trick, going to the visibility map, and therefore it can apply all the conditions, also if there are conditions which could cause an exception. So if we look into this picture, we have now basically reduced the number of heap accesses down there. There might still be something left because the visibility map is not always perfectly clear. That's the way it is. If you put something new into your data, you also end up with some heap accesses there. So it sees, at the index level, it checks the visibility. And if the visibility map says, yes, it is visible, then it will also apply the filter. If not, it goes down to the heap, checks the visibility, and only if it is visible, then it will apply the filter. The filtering is always done after checking the visibility map. So it's not actually true that it doesn't help the where clause. It still helps it, but only for index-only scan. So this entire include thing is at the moment only for index-only scan. Let's go further. Another disadvantages. I already mentioned that the include columns are not considered for the order of the logical entries in the tree. So now I have put some order by on this data and limit one at so-called top-end query. And they can be optimized quite insanely well if you have the right index. So if you have the index on k data, like I have it here, you might get some index scan which reads no more data than the one row, because the index is already ordered by this data, because it's the second column. And then it only needs to go to the first entry, and that one can be taken, and that's it. And you might see that there is something you don't see. Can you spot what's missing in there, in this execution plan? There is no sort operation, even though we have an order by clause there. It's optimized away because the index already has the required order. But if we put the data column into the include part of the index, that part is not considered in the ordering. So what we end up is it will read again many rows from the index, pass them on to the heap table to do the visibility check and the filtering, and then it will eventually sort all of them and limit. So you see there is a huge difference. Now, instead of just going through the tree and taking the first entry, it goes through the tree, reads 1,000 rows, looks 1,000 times into the heap table, then sorts everything, and then just discards all but one row. There is a big, big performance difference. So another disadvantage, it cannot use order by. But besides advantages and disadvantages, there are also a few differences. They are, in some regard, they are just different, not better or worse than the other ones. And this is about constraints. And this is where it becomes really, really interesting. So right now, you can, of course, have a primary key or unique constraint on as many columns as you would like to. And this will then allow you to insert different values there. As long as the total combination is unique, it is fine. But now, you can also have the include clause on these constraints, basically. which means you can put additional data into the index which is not considered for guarding the uniqueness. So if you do so, you will not be able to insert the same one, because now it makes sure that only the key part, the first column, is unique, and as you can see there, there's a one and there's another one that won't be accepted. That means you can now extend an index for primary key or unique constraint and put include columns there to allow an index-only scan without breaking the constraint. That was not possible before. Before, you could only add another index if you wanted to. And that's, I think, a very, very important use case for the include clause at the time. So this is clearly a difference. It's neither a benefit nor a drawback. You just have to know about it. So that brings me to one more advantage I would like to talk about. It's one which is really, let's say, a little bit a meta advantage. It's not really a runtime advantage. It's more like an organizational advantage. It's about the three powers of indexing. So if you know that cute squirrel, who knows that? Okay. I have some coasters and stickers with that if you need. You can just grab them afterwards. So that's the mascot of my website, usetheindexlook.com, which is also available in French, by the way. Don't worry, I didn't do the translation. Is Guillaume here? No. Okay. So it's basically a book about indexing, how to make good use about indexing. You can read it online for free, you can also buy it, but you don't need to, you can read it for free. And there I make a point that an index, a B-tree index, can be used for three distinct things. And the first one, and the most important one, of course, is to find data quickly. This is what everybody knows about. And we have already seen, if you think about this include column, it doesn't really cover the where clause. It doesn't help the where clause at the moment because of this visibility issue. So that's not really able to use that power with the include clause. The second power is clustering data. That means to make sure that all the data you want to have in one query is stored closely to each other. In particular, store it in the index instead of going to the table later on. So that's the index-only scan. And this is clearly a check mark. So if you put something in the include clause, it can be used for clustering data. And finally, last but not least, sorting data, the third power of indexing. And we have already seen that is not supported by the include clause per definition. So what does this mean? Only one of them, it actually works. That tells you something. If you look into your database and you see an index like that one, you just describe something and you see an index like that, then you don't know anything about the reasons why those columns are in this index. Why are you there? Where are you coming from? I don't know. Is this an arbitrary order? Is it the way it must be key and then data? Or could it work the other way around as well? We don't know. Maybe data was put in there for an index-only scan, but it's not written there. I don't know. So if you have such an index and want to optimize, let's say, a query like this, there is something interesting. So it's filtering by the key, which is there in the first position in the index. So that's fine. But then we are ordering by some timestamp descending to get the most recent first and doing the limit one, so the most recent row first. With that index, what is going to happen is that all the rows that match the key filter are taken, are ordered, and all but one of them is discarded. That's what we have seen before. So if you have this query and you would like to optimize it, a better index for that would be, or let's look at these things. You have basically three options how to optimize this query. And the first one is you could maybe extend that index which is already there and put the timestamp column at the last position, which will be at least an index-only scan, but it won't help the ordering, because for the ordering, we would need to have the TS column in the second position, right after where we are searching on. So yeah, it could be done, but it's not very useful. To get a good ordering, we would need to add the TS column after the key, right here in between. But unless we don't know, as long as we don't know why this order is there, we don't know what we're going to break, when we add the TS column in there. And frankly speaking, it's a pretty dangerous option, because if there is a query that looks like that, that uses key equals and data equals, then that query will become slower if we put in the TS column in the second position. Also, if we order by date instead of TS and do the limit one trick, then also that query would become slower if we would put in the TS column in the second position. So inserting something in between is almost never a solution. It's only appending at the end, which can be done at some kind of certainty that we don't break anything. So the third option is, of course, adding a new index, which means more overhead. It needs space. It needs it makes the writing slower, all these write amplification problems. The optimizer, the planner, has a harder job to do. It has to think about more options, which index to use. So it makes quite a lot of options bad. So the question is how to solve these things. You have that index. You don't know why that index is the way it is. And you would like to optimize another query. And yeah, well, which option would you take? Nobody? Maybe hand signs. Huh? Who would take the first option? Add TS as last column. Nobody? Okay, then second option, break some other query. Okay. Third option, create another index. Ah, safety first. Yeah, it is the way it is. I mean, it is just, you cannot calculate that. But now look. If some guy was kind enough to put that into the include, because he only needed to have that data there for the index-only scan. Now the picture changes, because now we know that part is not used for searching and also not for ordering. That means those two reasons, it's crossed out. It cannot break anything if we add the TS into the key after that first column. Now that's fine. It's a safe option, and we don't need another index. So this is really something really important, I think, to document. Because on the long run, indexes evolve like tables evolve. That's the way it is. And some years later, you will find an index, and you will see, oh, it's so close to what I actually need. I would just need to put in one more column here in the middle, and then everything would be perfect for this query you're optimizing right now. But you cannot. You cannot, because you don't want to break anything else. So to put it into this overview, I think one of the really important advantages, which most people are not aware about, is that it actually documents something about the reason why this column is in the index. So here it is. And I think this is really one of the underestimated reasons how to use that. And it's really it can save you another index in some years from now, which is basically a lot. We should save indexes. I love indexes. The fewer, the better. It's as simple as that. So, looking at the elephants, which play with other animals as well, to conclude on this include. Conclude on include. Mm-hmm. So, the include clause is generally ignored by everything except index-only scan. That's what you know by now, as of Postgres 11. That means you should definitely not move columns from the key part of an index into the include clause right away. It will save you a few percent of space, and it will make the tree a little bit smaller, but it will break half of your queries. Somebody else's problem. On the other hand, if you're adding columns to an index for the sole purpose to enable an index-only scan, please use the include clause. Some future people looking at those indexes and reasoning about why, how did you come there, will then understand that this is only used for index-only scan, and this implies opens some more doors how to evolve your indexes and keep the number of indexes as little as possible for whatever you need. And of course, also for primary keys and unique keys, that's also you can now extend an index that is used for a primary key so that it also can be used for an index-only scan on some other columns. So I'm already coming to the end. It was a short talk, I see. Some things, use the indexlook.com, my website, where you can maybe in a few weeks from now read a more detailed article about that. So I will repeat everything there and go into some more details. That's me. Can you recognize that? That guy? Yeah, that's me, like 10 years ago. Didn't age well. Yeah. Well. So that's me. I pronounce my name as Wienand. You know, that's from the German pronunciation. And you can visit that website and find some services from me. And of course, I do have another website, Modern SQL. Who knows that? Ah, yes. I also have stickers. Okay, just come up and grab some stickers. So I think we might have some minutes left. So these are my websites. They are entirely for free. You can find a lot of good SQL stuff over there. And yeah, well, if you have questions, I take them now. Yes.
Hi. Why not use the included columns for sorting anyway if it's there already, and maybe optimize some more queries? I know not all data types can be sorted, but if they can, why not use it? Because it seems like an artificial reason not to do
actually,
it.
Actually, the include clause doesn't have any operator class associated with it. So it's just the whole idea of this include clause is it drops everything except what you need for the index-only scan. And it makes also some kind of updates more fast, because it doesn't need to keep them in order. It's just, if you need to have it sorted, put it in the key. The drawback is not really, really big. You have seen just a few percent of space and maybe one more level or two more levels in a tree, but that's it. It's just, yeah, it is that way. Any other questions? If you don't have questions, I come up with questions. Okay. Uh-oh, exam. No questions? So how do you feel about include? Does it make sense to use? Can you see a use case in your environment? Yes, at least a few. Yeah. So the only danger is basically that you expect that it is used for filtering, which it isn't, because always the visibility check has to be done first. And a question?
Can you give us an example how many columns you have put for this payload? 10, 5, 20, 50?
In my example?
I mean, you work with it.
Yes.
Give us a real case. And what type of columns were those? Long strings, numbers?
Yes. The main benefit is if you have some longer strings, like names or whatever, the payload which you are fetching from the index in that case, basically, as opposed to some IDs or dates, they are pretty dense, then you won't see the big advantage in the space savings. But even if you ignore the space savings, the documentation characteristics is still there. So I don't think about, does it make sense because it's only a tiny bit of data? It won't save a lot of space if I put it in the include rather than into the key. That's not the way I'm thinking about it. As soon as I only need it to have it in the include, I put it in the include, because that allows me later on to do more flexible index evolution. But other than that, you can put in as many as you can anyway. So you have the limits, like for the key columns. I don't know it by heart. Is it 32 columns or 16, something to like, 32, I think, and about 2 kilobytes of payload, 2.6 kilobytes of payload. So these are just the normal limits for keys as well. It's page size third.
Just to address your question a second ago, it seems the one case where I've had to use it in production, the big payoff was when the actual table itself had a very large number of columns and rather heavy columns, and several queries needed to use just a few of those. So avoiding actually going to the heap was really of primary importance. But again, those particular columns just weren't needed for the sort, and you also wanted to clue the planner in that we're only going to be looking on sorting on these first three columns as opposed to the six or seven that ended up being in it.
So that's the general benefit of index-only scan, basically. But now you can make it in a different way. Okay, anything else? Oh, more questions coming. Yeah.
Would you ever consider adding an include clause to a primary key?
Yes,
which
absolutely.
Which is also used for many other things which might not need it, or is it, yeah?
Absolutely. If it can save an index, yes, absolutely. I mean, it makes the primary key a little bit more bigger, of course, no question. But the question is really how often do you actually query the primary key? In many...
Every join?
It depends on your join columns. Every join, it really depends on your queries. In many cases, the primary key is really just, you know, a surrogate key which does basically nothing except being unique. It really depends on the use case. But yes, I would definitely consider it. Instead of adding a new index, I think it will be pretty much always the better option. The number of indexes is a bigger concern regarding performance than the size of each index individually. There was another question, I think.
Is there still a benefit if the column is frequently updated? I mean, your select would be faster, but you will have a heavy overhead for write.
Yeah.
If the column in the include is frequently updated.
Well, Postgres is a bit special here because as soon as you have the column in any index, you need the tuple needs to be multiplied anyway. So it really depends on if this is the first index you're adding this column into, if that column is not in any other index on the table, then it makes a big difference, but the same is also for the key column. Otherwise, it could be a heap-only tuple, but you don't know. So I don't think that it makes a big difference in the whether you have it key versus include. But it makes a big difference if it is the first index you're putting in that column. If that answers your question. Yeah, you know, in Postgres, every time, basically, when you do an update, you will have a new row version, which might need to be added to all the indexes anyway. Because if you want to find that row version, you need to add it to all the indexes. Okay. Question?
Yes. Can we include computed value into include?
Can you include computed value? No, I don't think so. I think you can also not use function. No, you cannot. You cannot have functions in there, expressions in there. But you can, the index only scan can then apply that function. It can use that as an input to the function. It's just payload, yeah. More questions?
Yeah.
Yes.
Let's say I have two different indices using the same key columns with different includes. Does the query optimizer chooses the right one?
I don't know.
Yeah.
In a good index design, I try to avoid these situations.
You may need, because you may need, if you have several columns, you may want to partition that into two different indices.
If the key columns are the same and the include columns are different, then I would have only one.
You would have
one
only
index
one?
Which all the include columns. Oh, in
whatever the number of the columns. Whatever the number of included columns.
Pretty much, yes. I mean, of course, there might be some rare cases where it is becoming so big that it doesn't work out. For example, when you reach the hard-coded limit, kind of hard-coded of 2.6 kilobytes, you can put into the key row, in the index row. But other than that, yes, I would prefer. So my preference is always fewer indexes is more important than small indexes.
Just maybe it's more of a thought than a question, but it seems to me like it was the include clause was developed in like the purpose of enabling the index only scan.
Yes.
Has it really been designed developed in that purpose?
Yes.
And just that, or is it is there maybe a plan of developing it more to, I guess, appeal to other situations, maybe?
So yes, it was developed for index-only scan, that's the one reason, and in particular for index-only scan on unique constraints, I think. Other than that, I think it could be put at use for other situations as well. As you have seen there, I have had a filter on data which is in the index, but the index scan or bitmap index scan just ignored it. I think there it would be nice to have some other situations, but it turned out that the reason is there because the sequence needs to be kept. Only safe operations are checked, then the visibility is checked, and then potentially unsafe operations are checked. And yeah, that's the way it is right now. I don't know if that will change in the near future. I would hope for it. Okay. More questions? That were a lot, anyway. So if we are done.
Yes, well, thank you.
Well, thank you.